Here in this video today, we will discuss the seven most tragic events revolving around the sons of the Emperor, the Primarchs, their ordeals, their slow descent into madness or chaos, and more. So let's get to it. Firstly, the tragic death of Ferus Manus, the Primarch of the Iron Hands Legion. It occurred during the Horus Heresy, a cataclysmic civil war within the Imperium of Man. The sad thing is that Ferus Manus actually had a close bond with his brother Primarch Fulgrim of the Emperor's Children. But their loyalties would ultimately diverge, leading to a couple of devastating confrontations. As the Horus Heresy unfolded, Fulgrim was swayed by the dark forces of Chaos and attempts to convince Ferus Manus to join the traitor cause. Ferus, loyal to the Emperor and infuriated by Fulgrim's betrayal, rejected the offer and attacked Fulgrim when he refused to change his allegiance. A fierce and emotional duel ensued between the two Primarchs, and during the battle, Ferus destroyed Fulgrim's sword Fireblade, a weapon he had gifted to Fulgrim in the past. However, Fulgrim, with the power of Chaos on his side, managed to render Ferus unconscious and took back the Warhammer he had forged for him. In the second confrontation, Fulgrim used the Demon Blade of Lair, a Xenos weapon corrupted by Chaos, to decapitate the head of Ferus Manus in a single strike, which is a fatal blow. Ferus Manus died on the battlefield that day on Isvan V, betrayed and slain by his own brother, and this act of fratricide was a tragic event since both brothers love each other dearly. The second tragic event, Curse's descent into madness. In the tale of Conrad Curse, known as the Night Haunter, his preferred name, we find a tragic figure haunted by relentless, dark visions of the future. These nightmarish glimpses tormented him throughout his life, setting him apart from his fellow Primarchs. The psychic agony and despair born from these visions scarred his psyche irreparably, leaving him forever unbalanced and yearning for an escape from his painful existence. From the very beginning, Curse was a deeply damaged soul. He embraced brutality and savagery in his approach to warfare and justice, believing that fear was the most potent weapon one could wield against their enemies. Curse, unlike other Primarchs, did not relish his role as a leader in the Imperial War Machine, the Great Crusade. He also had little affection for his sons, the Night Lords, the Space Marines created from his genetic template. His unique gift of foresight allowed him to glimpse certain future events, although in cryptic and allegorical forms, but it was the recurring and excruciatingly detailed visions of his own death that truly haunted him. He became trapped in a cycle of inevitability, where his fate seemed sealed by the visions that he could not escape, which was why he allowed the assassin Imshen to take his life, tired of waiting for an eventuality, even though it was his own actions that led to his grim fate. The third tragic event, the death of Sanguinius. So the Primarch Sanguinius, also known as the Great Angel and the Brightest One, was in many ways often considered the noblest and most respected of the Primarchs, even by his other brothers, and also Horus. But he was a flawed character and had to silently battle his red thirst and protect his sons from being purged if the gene flaw was ever to be publicized. So during the final stages of the Horus Heresy, in the Siege of Terror, as an embodiment of the powers of Chaos, Horus killed the powerful Sanguinius. Just like Fulgrim killing Ferus Manus, who had once been his closest and greatest friend among the other Primarchs. But a sad thing about this is that Sanguinius, like Conrad Curse, was gifted with foresight and precognition. He had seen his moment of death play out in his mind 1,000 times, and could not see past the eventual battle. Unlike Curse, however, he remained faithful to the Emperor and also humanity, and decided that if this was to be the end, it shall be like none other. And that was how it went, out of a sense of duty. Horus, driven by his boundless malevolence, ensured that Sanguinius' death was excruciating and vile, employing the darkest forces at his disposal. The psychic torment he inflicted during that battle reverberated not only through space but also across the ages, leaving a lasting mark on the souls of Sanguinius' descendants, the Blood Angels, forever as the Black Rage. The fourth tragedy, Horus' final moments. During the Siege of Terror, the climactic battle in the Horus Heresy, the Emperor of Mankind confronted Horus on the chaos-infested battle barge called the Vengeful Spirit. Their fierce duel ended with the Emperor of Mankind defeating Horus and inflicting mortal wounds on him. Unfortunately, the Emperor also suffered severe life-altering injuries during this confrontation. The most heartbreaking moment of this battle occurred after the ruinous powers briefly departed from Horus' body, allowing him to regain consciousness. In a tragic twist, the emperor also foresaw the dire consequences of sparing his son's life. For Horus' last words, as regarded in the Visions of Heresy, were filled with regret and despair.
I have been a fool. I was so wrong. Everything is ruined, and I have betrayed you, my father. I do not ask for forgiveness. End my torment, kill me now, for I am too weak to resist them. They call me. Please end this.
What makes this situation even more heart-wrenching is that Horus expressed these sentiments in a hidden corner of his soul that retained the true essence of who he once was. He cried out, screamed, and begged for it all to be a dreadful nightmare and for it all to end. But his pleas were unheard. In his final moments, he desperately called out to his father, but all that emanated from his body was the mocking laughter of the fleeting ruinous powers. That was all before the emperor extinguished his soul and obliterated him. Number 5, Fulgrim's slow possession. So Fulgrim's path to damnation and utter corruption wasn't really of his own making. His descent from the Emperor's grace began on the Xenos planet called Laren, inhabited by the serpentine Lair species that were corrupted Xenos worshippers of the chaos god of pleasure called Slaanesh, of which Fulgrim and his space marines had no idea about. So in the oceanic planet in the nexus points of certain coral islands was a temple, a grand temple. And in it was a dark secret, a powerful chaos artifact. The artifact was a beautifully crafted single-edged demon blade called the Blade of Lair, serving as a vessel for a greater demon devoted to Slaanesh, but that was all a secret, nobody knew that. Once Fulgrim claimed this blade for himself, a demon residing within it began whispering into his mind, slowly corrupting his soul and drawing him towards the service of Slaanesh. Fulgrim found himself increasingly drawn to wield this demon blade over the previous weapon, the Greatsword Fireblade, which had been forged for him by his beloved brother and fellow Primarch, Ferris Manus. Initially, Fulgrim believed that the whispers were his own subconscious thoughts. However, he eventually realized that they were the insidious whispers of the demon residing in the blade. But by that time, it had already got a hold of him and was impossible to break free from, and at the same time satisfied his own desire for endless perfection, which was his nature. So this slow tragic fall culminated on Isvan V when he killed his brother Ferris Manus and became a demon prince. Number 6, Luther betraying the Lion. Luther was the individual who discovered and raised the Primarch Lionel Johnson on the planet of Caliban, treating him like his own child and even giving him his name. Luther went from being a fatherly figure to the Lion to becoming his best friend over time. While on a campaign with Lion against the Sarosh Xenos, Luther stumbled upon a bomb on their ship that could have killed the Primarch, and with some second thoughts and hesitation, his better judgment took over from jealousy and deactivated it. But despite this, the Lion somehow detected Luther's hesitation, leading to a falling out between them. The Lion then ordered Luther and his forces to return to Caliban, and when the Lion returned to Caliban after the heresy, Luther attacked his fleet and they engaged in a one-on-one battle. In this fight, Lionel Johnson injured Luther, but he couldn't bring himself to kill his oldest and dearest friend. But in contrast, Luther, driven by merciless intent and also corrupted by chaos, unleashed a sorcerous blast that mortally wounded Lionel Johnson, putting him in stasis for 10,000 years. But Luther at that moment realized how far down he had gone and the dark path that he has been in, and began to regret and weep over his actions. So this dynamic between the Dark Angels and Caliban reflects some of their broader themes and conflicts within the Imperium of Man as a whole, acting as a microcosm of the Horus Heresy. And number 7, Angron's early days in Nuceria. Angron had a tragic upbringing as well as an even sadder departure from his homeworld. Like the others, the Vortex took a young Angron and landed him on a distant planet, and this world was called Nuceria. It was a technologically advanced one and ruled over by a wealthy elite who lived in a decadent opulence while the populace of their cities lived in abject poverty in the slums that surrounded their walled palaces and villas. For distraction from revolution, they entertained the public with gladiatorial games, much like old Rome, using cybernetically enhanced gladiators who battled to satisfy the endless bloodlust of the oppressed people. Angron was discovered by a slaver and was later forced by the ruling clan of the city into the arena to fight in the games. He was also implanted with the Butcher's Nails, which were cybernetic cortical implants on the brain that drilled into the brain causing immense pain and rage for battle. In the years that followed, Angron and his fellow gladiators rebelled, much like Spartacus, but on a fateful day, the Emperor, who had been watching him for months, decided to bring Angron back to the fold to lead the 12th Legion in the Great Crusade. But surprisingly, Angron refused this, and instead wished to die alongside his rebel army. So seeing that his son would die if he fought the Nusairian army, he teleported him away, and with that, the leaderless rebellion was slaughtered to the last man standing, and Angron broke to tears seeing it happen in real time. Ever being resentful to his father for not helping or for not letting him fight with his friends to the end. So that's what I think are the 7 greatest tragedies that happened to the Primarchs within the Warhammer 40k universe. Anyway, we've come to the end of it. Subscribe and like to support this channel. And while you're at it, bang on that bell icon for notifications on new video uploads like this one. Till the next time, take care, boys.